Quabo, good evening, everyone. Thank you for joining us this evening for our August virtual orientation. So we're going to get it started with an update from the virtual village. So we're going to turn it over to Reverend Karima.
Thank you. Good evening once again, everybody. Hope you all are having or had a good day and having a wonderful evening. I just want to take a few minutes to share a couple of things that we're doing in the virtual village. You may or may not be aware. So I'm just going to take a moment here and share my screen. Can I get a okay from someone if you can see my screen?
Okay.
Very good.
Okay. Yeah. What I'm doing now, of course, is sharing the landing page for the Linktree. Our Linktree is what we use. It's our outreach tool to communicate very basic information about our church. A couple of things I want to point out that we've added to the Linktree recently. Number one, you can see here the phone number. This is the phone number to the virtual office that's been added to the Linktree. So if someone asks you about contacting us via phone, you can give them this number. This number will be directed to an IVR prompt, which will allow a caller to indicate the location that they're trying to get to. Everybody dials the same number, and once you get in, you dial a prompt on the phone to get to a specific location. The phone number is here. It is also here under locations and service times, and it has always been on this page here. The phone number is here, and down here is the phone number that I'm not sure if this is correct for the Cultural Center, and if it's not, we'll change it. But this is a phone number for the Atlanta Cultural Center. So I just wanted to share that one thing with you, and I have one other thing to share. Let's see if I can get back to it. Okay, here we go. And the other thing I wanted to point out is that we have added a calendar to the Linktree. It's an online calendar. This calendar is designed to connect our friends and community with our online events. Basically, you just click the link and it directs you to a calendar that shows the events that are open to the public on a particular day. These times you see here are shown in Eastern time. However, the time display based upon whatever your computer is set up, wherever your computer is set up. So if your computer is, if you happen to be on Central time, the time will appear in Central time, right? So for example, where are we now? We are in August, right here. We are in August 26th, and my orientation calendar shows 8 p.m. But someone in Houston or Central time, this calendar should show 7 p.m. The default is to whatever time zone your computer or your mobile device is set up to. This calendar can be displayed on the computer, which is what you see here. You can also display this calendar on your smartphone, on your smart device, your iPad, your phone, and you can display all of these events. Another thing about this is that you can click directly on the link, and it allows you to click on the link to the Zoom call, if it's a Zoom call. In the case of Sunday service, you click on online experience, and it takes you to the website, Shrine Online. This link here is for afterwards. That's the program that we have that immediately follows the online message on Sundays. And I'm in the process of going back out to this calendar and putting a little bit more detail around these events to kind of just a very brief, not even a synopsis, maybe one or two sentences to tell you what this is and who we recommend attend these events. Because maybe not everybody wants to attend everything and may not be interested in everything. But if you have a little bit more information around what's being shared at these events, you might it might be helpful. So I've got to go out and update that. But I just wanted to take a few minutes to show you all that. And another thing, quickly, you have options to display this calendar in different views. This is a more traditional calendar view that kind of looks like Outlook. You have an option. This is the month at a glance. So this allows you to see an entire month at a glance. And then there's an agenda view, which gives you, I don't know what you call this. It's not like swim lanes, but it's a day of the week and you see everything in this view. I personally like this one. It's fairly easy to read and very clear. So basically that's what I had to share. And we're gonna try to keep this calendar current as much as possible. But please, when you have questions, come out here, take a look. If you have questions about an event or something, come out here and take a look. This calendar does not represent region specific information. This is for national information. My recommendation is that if regions desire to have a calendar, that they should be created by the region. Are there any questions?
Yeah.
That's it for me, Bishop Mbayu, unless you had something else for me.
Somebody had a question. Makalani, was that you?
Yeah, it was me. I thought she said that the orientation for was at 8 o'clock or 7 o'clock for depending on the region that you were in. Is that true?
Yeah.
Did I make my point clear?
No, the calendar displays the time that's associated with your computer or your mobile device. So for example, sometimes I'm in Houston and sometimes I'm in Detroit, but when I'm in Houston, because my calendar is associated with East Coast time show up on my calendar when I'm in Houston. I know that, so I just make the adjustment. The calendar is going to display with the time zone that your device is associated with.
Okay.
I hope that makes sense. And if it's not, I'm happy to, you know, talk about it further if you have questions or set up some time and kind of walk with you through it just to show you.
That's all right. I just was wondering, you know, 8 o'clock is a little late for me. I was hoping that it might be 7 o'clock, but if the national virtual orientation is at 8, I'll try to make them then.
Okay, thank you.
Yeah, we have to accommodate different time zones. That's why it's a little late for us on the East Coast.
I know. I figured as much.
Thank you for your understanding. Rem Karim, I just wanted to mention in terms of the calendar, if you go to the calendar and you see the event that you're looking for, but it's at a different time, you can still click on the link and join that event. And the other thing about the calendar is you don't need a link, right, to get into a Zoom. Before we started using links, what did we do? How did we get into a Zoom? We used the ID number.
Yes.
So I would suggest to everyone to write down the ID numbers for the meetings that you attend on a regular basis. That way you won't have to have a link. You just use your ID. And we've removed all passcodes for all meetings. So there is no passcode. All you need is the meeting ID number, right? And that number is always there. So you don't need a link to join. All you need is the ID number.
And there may be a couple of time changes that we'll go out and update. So what you see, if you go out there tonight, there may be a slight change by tomorrow. So
yeah, there are going to be some changes for sure.
Yeah.
Especially with the training and development schedule, it's going to change. And that will be posted in news around the nation, and it'll also be updated on the calendar. Anything else, Reverend Karima?
No, that's all I have.
Okay, so we want to give a overview, kind of brief overview of what's been going on post-Synod for the last 7 or 8 weeks. And we want to kick it off with a short interview. So during the Synod, we did a lot of interviews talking about succession planning and how we see our movement reimagined. So we're going to share one of those videos this evening coming from one of our millennials as she talks about how she sees the future and the role of young people in the future of our movement.
What time is it?
It's nation time.
So my name is Ayo. Ayo Thomas is my name. Ayo translates to joy. I grew up in the Central Region, Shrine Number 1. I also lived in Atlanta, Shrine Number 9, as a young adult. I grew up in the Shrine in Central Region, and my mother is also a member of the church. And in later years, I've had other members of my family also join. And so what that means to me in terms of membership and the existing legacy of the Shrine is connecting to people who are about liberation, who are like-minded, and are willing to exist in a counterculture or in an environment that is not quite the same as everything that might be happening around it, and being intentional about cultivating that so that you can continue to cultivate free thinkers and people who are about the liberation of Black people and the love of Black people, because you cannot have liberation without love. And so what I say in terms of moving forward and carrying that narrative and that legacy forward is that I am constantly working on how to live my life with those principles in mind. So whether I'm in a church facility or out in the world, operating from a space where love is paramount and where legacy and liberation are always at the forefront of the conversation and always at the forefront of my decision making as well. When I talk to my friends about their childhood, I've never talked to anyone who's had a comparable experience. So whether you're talking about living in a Mtoto house or being on the Shrine Warriors cheer team or going to the basketball games or summer camps or gardening or any of the programs that were created or implemented to build us into strong, again, Black liberation-minded people, I'm not really sure how to capture it in a short amount of words, except for that it helped you to build a sense of camaraderie and community with people who only understand that experience because they went through it with you. And that's a beautiful thing. Specific memories that come to mind, being in on the seventh floor, I remember had to be late elementary school, but I had a pair of Sailor Moon slippers and we would be in the room on Saturday mornings, either going through, you know, Kazi or the Kazi being work, so cleaning up and taking care of our space, or any of the other things we were doing. I just remember like playing in the closet. I don't know why we were playing, but I remember playing in the closet in my Sailor Moon slippers, or being on the cheer team and practicing and getting ready for competitions. You would have thought that we were in a national competition, the way we were practicing, the way we were preparing. And even though it was us against competing against other church cheer teams, we took it incredibly seriously. I'm talking uniforms, I'm talking hairstyles, the music choices, the routines. We just put so much into it. And it's really funny because that's around like maybe late middle school, early high school. And so as you're transitioning into that stage, you're really trying to figure out like, what's my identity gonna be at this stage? And so it's really interesting moving through that in church in a particular way that's kind of, sometimes it's not separate from, but it's a part of your identity that people may or may not know. Like I grew up dancing. And so often when people know me outside of the church, they think of my dancing, but not, may not even realize that I was also on the cheer team. I think it's definitely contributed to my understanding of what it means to be a part of a community and what cohesion means. Cohesion for me is not sameness, but it is moving forward with a shared goal, with a shared agreement. around what outcomes should be. And so being okay with tension, being okay with questioning, being okay with taking on a role, maybe one that you don't even want because there's a goal and a job to be done. And so I think that those are all things. And also being really, like I said, being really grounded in liberation and understanding what that means. Those are all things that, you know, even if I wanted to, I think they're so deeply ingrained in me that I don't know that I could walk away from them because they're part of my value system. They're something that I use to filter my way through life. And so I would say that those are probably some of the most impactful takeaways. Also, that there are going to be forever people who I call brother and sister who, again, shared that same experience, maybe not even at the same period in time, or maybe not even in the same place. But if we need each other or, you know, whatever that is, it is my commitment to be there. So. I think it's building connections with other young people, whether they are my age, younger, or older, depending on how you want to look at it. I think there's a shared recognition of what it can be, and that it doesn't have to look like we think it looks in mainstream or other traditional spaces, that we can decide what needs to be done and align that with our value system. I think it means knowing that there are, again, others who share a value system, who want to see the same thing for themselves or for their children or for a future that many of us will never even see, knowing that there's an opportunity to be liberated, to not just achieve liberation, but to maintain it and to cultivate it generation after generation after generation. What would I say to young people who are coming up now, who consider themselves to be Black nationalists? My advice would be to learn, to read, and to get to the essence of the intention behind the thing. Because living things and movements are living things, right? A liberation movement is a living thing. In order for that to continue to grow, it has to be appropriate and adaptable to the times. And so maybe it's not about repeating the same process, but reaching the same goal in a way that's makes sense for your era, that makes sense for your time period. So I would say never be afraid to try a new way, as long as you're clear on what your goals are, and understand that community and cohesion are not sameness. It does not require everybody to be the same, look the same, do the same thing. It requires a recognition of humanity, of a shared sense of outcome, a shared value system, and moving forward. I'm not sure what my big takeaway is yet, but the thing that continues to, I think, show up for me so far is that we have to continue to explore new ways of achieving not necessarily the same tasks, but the same goal. And that at some point there has to be someone there to take over. And so if you don't cultivate the next generation, that you will be seeking it. And so it's important to make sure that you maintain those connections and that you cultivate those who will come after you, because there are people who came before you who sought to do the same thing. I think everyone should see Beulah Land once in your life, at least. Just come and be in this space, because hearing about it and seeing it are two totally different things. And seeing it makes it tangible in a way that no description can really do. That's it. Thank you.
Okay, so that was the voice of Sister Ayo from the Mother Shrine, sharing her experience of the Synod. And we're going to continue as we move forward to blend the voices of all of our generations, right? Because our legacy represents multi-generations. And I think it's important for us to be able to connect with the insight and understanding of each of our represented generations. So we're going to go on and kind of talk about what's been happening since the synod in terms of the Board of Trustees. I'm going to turn it over to Reverend Tayo.
Thank you. Hello, everyone, and I hope you had a wonderful day. I am pleased to share with you what has been happening with the reimagining process, part of the succession planning process that we embarked on over a year ago now. So the reimagining of BCN as it relates to the local boards of trustees. Can everyone see my screen?
Sure. No.
Yes.
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 Okay. All right. Okay. So one of my favorite actors and one of his favorite quotes: take a stand for what's right, raise a ruckus, and make a change. You may not always be popular, but you'll be part of something larger and bigger and greater than yourself. Besides, making history is extremely cool. Samuel L. Jackson. So during the synod, on Synod Sunday, June 23rd, we made history. The newly elected and appointed regional boards of trustees were installed and charged with the responsibility of providing leadership on temporal matters. The Board of Trustees is the highest governing body of the regions. So here's our update for August. Atlanta held its inaugural board meeting and board orientation on Sunday, August 4th. All board members, Board of Trustee intern, and board advisors were present. It was a very engaging and inspiring meeting. So during that meeting, the board elected its officers, and the officers are Chair Walamu Olatunji, Vice Chair Reverend Ayana, Secretary Reverend Dr. Ishara. The board also met again that following Sunday, during which three subcommittees, Facilities Management or Building Restoration, Economic Development, and Policy Review were established. On this past Saturday, June 24th, the board and the subcommittees held a working session to tackle the issues at hand facing the region. So as you can see, Atlanta is up and running and going at it. And so we're very proud of the work that they are beginning to do. In Detroit, the Central Region Local Board of Trustees held its Board of Trustee meeting and orientation on Thursday, July 17th. All members were present. The initial meeting went well. Board members were engaged and sought and received answers to their questions. The board met again this past Thursday. There was a robust discussion on finance, policies and procedures, fundraising, and increasing membership. Board of Trustees officers for the Central Region are Brother Lutalo is the chair, Vice Chair is Elder Kojo, Secretary is Fundi Ando. In Houston, Shrine 9 conducted its Board of Orientation, Board of Trustee Orientation meeting via Zoom on Saturday, July 27th. Again, all went well. The election of officers and the transition of existing business projects to the new Board of Trustees were completed during the August 18th meeting. The officers of the Board of Trustees for Houston are Chair Reverend Aminata, Vice Chair Sister Nefertiti, Secretary Reverend Abaneste. In July, we had representatives from all three regions attending and participating in the first Board of Trustee training session, focusing on the book Think Again, which was facilitated by the pastor, Board of Pastors, specifically Baba Chui. In terms of board support, the work of the Board of Trustees focus group for the next 6 months is to provide support and guidance to the local Board of Trustees. At the request of the local Board of Trustees, regional focus group members will attend board meetings, serving in an advisory capacity only. And those regional focus group advisory members are from Detroit, Reverend Elijah and Sister Dara, Atlanta, Reverend Maia and Reverend Adai, and in Houston, Captain Zelani. Lastly, all regional congregations embraced and supported the reimagining of the BCN Local Board of Trustees. As reported last month, 73% of all eligible voters participated in the election process. And on behalf of the Board of Governors, I would like to say thank you to all the members who embraced this effort, supported it, and most importantly, exercised your right to vote in the election process. So, how can members communicate with their local boards of trustees? And also, how can you communicate with the National Board of Governors? Atlanta is working on getting their email address established. Detroit, Brother Lutalo is the chair. Here is their email address. So any member in Detroit or any member in the church, if you'd like to communicate with the Detroit Board of Trustees, board@POCC.org. Houston, Reverend Aminata is the chair, and their email address is trusteeboard10@gmail.com. And lastly, if you'd like to communicate with the National Board of Governors, I am the chair again, paocc.bog@gmail.com. Thank you very much. That ends my report, and I will toss it back if there are no questions. Thank you.
Thank you, Reverend Ifetayo. Any questions for Reverend Ifetayo? Okay, there being no questions, we're going to keep moving. So I wanted to briefly go over the succession planning training and development schedule. So right now we're still in the Think Again training module. We have two more sessions. They'll be happening in September, and boards of trustees will get an email copy of the schedule if you don't have it already. That's September 16th and September 30th, and the workshop will begin at 7:30 Eastern, 6:30 Central. The next phase of training will begin with the five dysfunctions of a team. That'll be led by Reverend Ifetayo. Starts on September the 9th. The second one is September 23rd, and then there'll be two sessions in October, same time, 7:30 p.m. Eastern, 6:30 Central. And then the last module of training for this year will be on the book, The Anxious Generation, and that's going to start October 16th, same time, 7:30. So all the trainings will be at 7:30, right? 6:30 Central Time. And I just wanted to give a little information about these trainings and why they're important and who should attend. So to think again, we touched on it briefly at the synod, but it's really about learning how to be most creative when we're in a group context, whether it's a meeting or a planning session or whatever the gathering is, whenever we're coming together to problem solve, right? These skills are important and can make us much more productive if we implement and practice them. So even though we're targeting the Board of Trustees in each location, it's still open to anybody who facilitates groups, right? And you wanna improve your skills and abilities in getting the most out of the group or the team that you're working with. So again, that's open to anyone who would like to attend. And the same thing with the five dysfunctions of a team. It's really about honing your skills in terms of leading a group, building, and working collectively to resolve problems. And then that third training, the Anxious Generation, is really targeting all of our teachers, youth workers, and parents. The book is very timely, and I really urge you to get the book if you're raising children or if you're raising grandchildren, because it really helps you understand what the fourth digital revolution has done in terms of rewiring the way that we think and behave. So it talks about the transition from the introduction of smartphones in 2007 and what that did for the generation of young people that were growing up for the first time with this access to the whole wide world at their fingertips. It's just an excellent read. And so I urge anybody who, like I said, is raising kids, if you work with the youth, you ought to be a part of this discussion, the anxious generation. So I want to switch gears and talk about focus groups. So we have three new focus groups that are coming online in the next few months. First one already started back in July. That's the Millennial Think Tank, facilitated by Reverend Lumumba. And that focus group is open to all millennials, possibly a few Gen X's. But that gathering is seeking to do critical and creative thinking around specific aspects of our program and mission, and to provide strategy, insight, action plans that will enhance and improve our effectiveness as best self movement. So in order to participate in that, please reach out to Reverend Lumumba directly. And his email address is lumumba.segers@gmail.com. And again, that's for millennials. The second focus group is the Bulan Focus Group, facilitated by Reverend Hanifa Ajuman from the Central Region from the Mother Shrines. And that group is open to all who share a passion for the development and growth of Bulan Farms. The main work of that group is to build collaborative partnerships as well as educational partnerships with other Black groups and organizations that are concerned about Black food security and the work of reclaiming and restoring our spaces, both at home and abroad. So for the meeting day and time, please reach out to Reverend Hanifa, and her email is ajuman93@gmail.com. Ajuman is ajuman93@gmail.com. And the third focus group that's coming online real soon is the Creative Writers Focus Group, co-facilitators Reverend Ishara and myself. And the Creative Writers Focus Group, some people have been asking what it's about. It seeks to produce creative content for both our in-person and our virtual presence, right? We have virtual platforms, but we don't have a lot of people bringing content to the virtual space. So we're tasking people to write, promote, advertise all of our content. So we're looking for writers. Let me say that again. We're looking for writers who are able to write promotions, advertisements, articles. Also, we're going to be introducing podcasts and other kinds of multimedia presentations, including stories, plays, and what have you. So we're going to be doing a lot of creative writing that can help elevate our countercultural value system and help make our teachings, our worldview, our mission, and our formal faith more accessible to those who seek to be a part of our movement. So those are three of the new focus groups. There are others that are being talked about, and we'll share those at a future time when they're formalized and ready to be introduced. But the more focus groups we can bring on board, the more people can have a place where they can participate in the reimagining process, right? So that's the hope, that everybody finds some place to get in and get involved. So I'm gonna switch gears again. Let's talk about Anniversary Month 2024, coming real soon to a theater near you. Our theme for Anniversary Month is embracing our transgenerational struggle. You're gonna get a copy of the Anniversary Month schedule in news around the nation this week. And it'll outline the events for Detroit, Atlanta, and Houston, who's preaching, what the events are, and what have you. But generally, during anniversary month, we're really trying to emphasize the continuity of preserving our legacy. So we're going to take a deeper dive on a few days throughout anniversary month into our legacy. We're going to go back to the video, Once There Was a Nation. It gives a big overview, but we're going to take a deep dive into those the different periods that the documentary talks about, and really kind of flush out our history for the benefit of those who joined at different times and weren't a part of that history. And it'll also be a time where you can ask a whole lot of questions and get a whole lot of answers. So that's going to be the main focus of our anniversary month, carrying on and preserving our legacy and trying to tie in how each generation can contribute to that process. And that's anniversary month. And then the last thing I want to share with you is information about the trip to Ghana. So people have been asking, we got a trip. You want to get involved and you want to go to the motherland, this is your time. February 2025 is going down. The dates are February 19th to the 28th. And again, you're going to get this whole leaflet in news around the nation this week. So embark on an exhilarating 9-day, 8-night adventure through Ghana, where history, culture, and natural beauty converge in a vibrant tapestry of experiences. Going to start your journey in Accra, exploring bustling markets and historic landmarks like the Kwame Nkrumah Mausoleum. Then it's going to travel down to Cape Coast to delve into the poignant history of the slave trade at the Cape Coast Castle. And also you have the opportunity to enjoy the serene beaches there. Discover the lush landscape and rich traditions of the Ashanti region. So we're going up north to Kumasi, visiting the opulent Manhia Palace and the local craft villages there. Then we're going to head to Haman for our historic welcome by the chief and the people of Haman, followed by a traditional naming ceremony and a visit to a public school in Haman. And then we're going to conclude the trip with a visit to the picturesque town of Elmina and its historic castle there, where you can immerse yourself in the vibrant culture and warm hospitality of the Ghanaian people. So this journey promises a blend of adventure, reflection, and culture, leaving you with lasting memories and a deeper appreciation for Ghana's unique heritage. So that's the trip that's been put together by our travel agent. It'll tell you all the information about what that trip is about, what the cost is, what's included in the cost, and your schedule for payments that need to be made. August? So probably around November, once we get a group committed to going, we'll get together and kind of talk it through, walk you through the process. This is your first time going, what you need to do and how to get your ducks in a row. So that's information about the trip to Ghana in 2025, February. So I'm going to turn it over to Reverend Black Slate. He's going to talk a little bit about the November election. I'm not sure if he's here. Is he here?
Anybody? I was on mute. Sorry about that. Do you want me to talk about activities that are planned as well?
I want you to say a little bit about the DNC for those of us who weren't there.
Well, that's actually where I was. I wasn't going to start at the DNC, but I was going to start at a convention that is really what I would say is a tale of two different worlds. I had the opportunity since the Senate with a great deal of anxiety through my work, attend both the RNC and the DNC. And as I mentioned, they're a tale of two different worlds, particularly with our vice president, Kamala Harris, now being the lead on the ticket. I mean, you talk about two different worlds. You know, one party, stood and spoke of a solid vision for our future, whereas the others had other party in their convention. It was a voice of hate and despair and desperation. One party in the Democratic Party, with under leadership of Harris, had a voice of inclusion, where the other one was about divisiveness and exclusion. One party that spelled out a vision of and a voice of hope, whereas the other one spoke of hopelessness. We talking about the difference between the party of victors versus those who are unjustified claiming to be victims. And so it really was a difference in attend difference in energy, difference in mood. And folks, if you what you felt on the screen is exactly the positive energy that I was able to navigate through and navigate in last week. Everything from rich conversations that were what I would call conference adjacent discussions around criminal justice reform, around environmental equity, and as we make this transition to clean energy, how do we make certain that those communities that have been underestimated and have largely been harmed due to environmental injustice, environmental racism, how do we really make those communities like the ones that we live in whole? Just a really uplifting mood with last week's events at the DNC. And many of you may know that two of the three regions are battleground states, sit within battleground states. And then there's a lot of interest being paid to Texas. Jeremoji, I think that there's, with the leadership and energy and the young folks in Texas are seeing things a lot differently than their parents. And so while it may not be considered a battleground state, I think that there are opportunities for us to organize, mobilize, and really continue to build a movement in the state. In this election, there is an opportunity for us to have an impact and really be, through the Black slate, what we were created to be. We have an opportunity to yet again make history with the not only the election of the first Black woman president, but the first woman president in this nation's history. And so I think it's important for us to collectively understand the importance of this moment, but also seize the moment. And so I can talk a little bit about, some of the activities that are going on. Certainly specifically in Detroit, we have a funding proposal before the Democratic Party that would allow us to put boots on the ground in a way that we have not put boots on the ground in the last, I tell you what, it would hearken us back to the 80s and 90s if we're able to get the funding proposal approved. And in this election, we're going to be going after unlikely voters. So often the party incentivizes us to go after the same pool of voters trying to drive out its base to the election, but it's our contention that we need to be driving new voters to the polls, and we're going to do that by identifying those who have not gone out to vote in the last three election cycles, and we're going to target those doors in a very specific way. Also, there are a couple of events that we have planned. We're working with the Democratic Party on an upcoming debate watch party in Detroit, but also we're partnering with Brickmasters to host at the church, Politrix? And that will be October 5th from 1 p.m. to 4 p.m. And we are in conversations with the Democratic Party about making this an official event. We're going to have people there who are going to break down the impact of Project 25 and one, help folks understand what it is, but also break down what the impacts, the detrimental and devastating impacts it could have if it were to be enacted into law. And then we will also have our traditional Black Slate rally as we get closer to Election Day. In Atlanta, there is a transition in leadership. And so I've had some conversations with some of the board members, but there still is a lot of interest in how we engage in this upcoming election cycle. Given the transition, we also see that this is an opportunity to engage some of our millennials in the Black Slate in the efforts. A lot of expressed interest there. And so, you know, in this transition, we know that there's going to be tough conversations that we have to have as we move forward. But we, again, believe that it's important for us to step in that space, courageously have those conversations, recognizing, again, the urgency of the moment. And then Reverend DJ, I have some ideas that I want to share with you about Houston. Again, the millennials are chomping at the bit to get involved. And so we'll be circling back up with that. But that's my report. I'm, again, pretty enthusiastic. For those who have certain ideas that they would like to discuss with me, please know that I would love to partner, to have conversations, you know, about some of the things that we can be doing to be innovative, to drive voter turnouts in our respective regions. I guess if I should give a contact information, since I did offer, I'll put it in the chat, but I also stated my telephone number, 313-957-1278. My email address is candia.milton@gmail.com. And I see Sekou said he had some ideas. I reached out to you, good brother. Hit me up, 313-957-1278.
Okay, Reverend Kareem, put it in the chat. Thank you.
Thank you.
Okay, so as we bring our orientation to a close, we're going to have announcements from the local pastors, starting with Detroit. Ongoing services for who's this week? Sister Patrina Sahinus Chapman, 6 o'clock at the Mother Shrine, Thursday, 6 p.m. And that's it. Atlanta, Bishop Mwenda.
Thank you. Just a reminder to the whole nation and to guests and friends, the African history class virtual, 12 to 2:30 every Saturday. You can go to News Around the Nation to get the Zoom information. We also want to welcome our recently baptized members into the faith here in the Southern region. Sister Jasmine Peters, Darryl Patterson, Sister Nia Donaldson, Brother Andrew Smith, and Brother Lamonte Whitaker. Also, this coming Saturday, we'll have Jazz Beats and Books, a concert that will be held in the Shrine of the Black Madonna Bookstore and Culture Center from 3 to 5 p.m. That concludes our announcements in the Southern region.
Thank you. Houston?
Thank you. I want to remind everybody that this coming Saturday on the 31st, we're going to continue with our weekly food giveaway. This is held every Saturday at 9 a.m. for volunteers and 11 a.m. for distribution. And also, we look forward to our Buy Black Marketplace, which will resume on September the 7th, Saturday, the first Saturday. And also invite everybody to attend our wonderful classes on the first and third Saturday of every month, Enter the Black Hole, facilitated by our own Pastor Swat Walker.
Thank you. Okay. Anything from Beulah Land, Baba Judah?
We're doing the same thing, preparing for the various groups that come in and out. We've had different groups that have come since the synod, doing research, talking, and fellowshipping. I think the main thing is that we wanted the nation to know, y'all to know that as this thing goes, that we're hopeful for us to do the right thing, but we're preparing for the worst, and we'll leave a light on for y'all. All the facilities are running and prepared, and if y'all feel that you want to leave something, you know, how we want to deal with it, please work through your pastor so that we can work it together on it. Thank you.
Thank you. Anything from Bila Kuta?
Bila Kuta, we probably won't have our usual meeting on Thursday because of the funeral services. So stay tuned. You will be getting a communication from me for next week. That's the Best Self Basics and also Shrine Bila Kuta group meeting.
Thank you. All right. Again, we thank everyone for joining us tonight. Hopefully you've been fed. And we look forward to seeing you again in this Zoom space on another day real soon. In the meantime, stay cool. I know that heat wave is coming across the country. Stay safe, because COVID and RSV and all them are still around.
Yeah.
Still around.
Sure is.
Come to a place full of people, won't hurt to mask up.
Amen.
Won't hurt to put on a mask. Just saying.
And by you, Nefertiti services next week.
Yeah, we don't have a time, right? So that's why I don't.
Your Dion's in out of time. 6 o'clock next Friday.
Okay. Thank you for that. Mm-hmm. 6 o'clock next Friday, September 6th. Who prayed this in? Bishop Mwinda, would you give us a prayer of benediction?
Yes, sir. Now unto her who is able to keep us from falling, to present us faultless before the presence of her glory with exceeding joy, to the one wise creator, our sustainer, be glory, majesty, dominion, and power until we meet again. And all those assembled said, amen and Ashe.
Amen. Amen and Ashe.
Amen, Ashe.
Amen and Ashe.
Amen. Night, everybody.
Good night.
Good night.
I'm gonna let you turn it off.
Good night.
Good night.